It was Friday afternoon, and Jesus is dead. His brutalized body hanging without life on a cross, dropped into a hole in the dirt. His executioners had dug the holes, prepared the place, and done their job with ruthless efficiency. This wasn't how it was supposed to be. The hope of mankind overcome by powers of hell, by the shadow of a grave. We once knew what it was like to rule and reign on the earth. We were made to live in the light, in relationship, in purpose. We were made for more than what we've come to accept as normal. Ever since the garden, Satan and his kingdom have been tightening their grip. Darkness has ruled, evil, chaos, suffering, hopelessness. We've been enslaved and crippled by the holes the enemy has been digging for us too. But instead of killing the Messiah, the cross became a catalyst for salvation. The hole that was dug to hold an instrument of shame and death was instead filled with an instrument to bring healing and new life. That's the way God is. Nothing is impossible with him. He's always restoring, always renewing, always able to take what was meant for evil and turn it for good, to take our graves and turn them into gardens. Why? Because he never gave up on his plan. He has never given up on us. He knows what we don't, that you can't have resurrection life without death, Jesus. He died so we can have lives of purpose and power over the grave. He is not dead, he is alive. And because he lives, we can live again.
The valley, You know you're having fun when you sing yourself hoarse, right? I love Easter. It is my favorite holiday. It is my favorite time of year. It's the epitome of the Christian calendar to celebrate Easter, to celebrate our risen Lord. I think it's a sad fact, though, that less and less people know what Easter means. Just this week, Greg, you remember you and I were talking, and he shared with me how he was wishing people, you know, a happy Easter, and a lot of them were confused, didn't really know what that meant. What does it mean to have Easter? And so a lot of people are confused about what Easter means. Even our technology is confused about what Easter means. Just this morning, Christy and I, at different times, we asked our Alexa speaker, right, to play some Easter music. And it responded by playing Love Songs by Desesperado. All right, I had no idea who Desesperado is, but the song was not in English, and it was definitely not related to Easter in any way. I don't think it was a Silicon Valley conspiracy against Christianity. I just understand that less and less people know what Easter means. Christianity, it's no longer mainstream in the United States. So those of you that made it here today or taking time to watch this online, you are part of a fringe group that not only acknowledges that there was a historical Jesus, but is taking the time to celebrate the resurrection. Most of you truly believe that the evidence that supports the facts of the resurrection, and I'm not saying recitation, I'm not saying reincarnation, but a resurrection. Jesus didn't just go unconscious. He didn't have a vision that determined, okay, heaven is for real. But the historical Jesus really died on a cross through crucifixion. He was pierced with a spear to ensure that he was dead. He was wrapped in burial cloths, and on the third day, he walked out of the tomb. The resurrection is the most important aspect of our faith. As Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, if Christ has not been raised, our faith is futile. We are still in our sins. And so the fact of the resurrection, he said that is the basis of the good news by which we're saved. He says earlier in 1 Corinthians 15 that it is the gospel preached to you, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. And he appeared to Cephas, to the 12, then more than 500 brothers at one time. And then he says most of whom, they're still alive. As I'm writing this, you can go and you can ask them. And so Christ rose from the dead. And there were people that personally witnessed the resurrected Christ. But most people still have trouble believing in the resurrection. I've often wondered why it was that Jesus didn't just come at a time like today, you know, when there's video evidence, where there's pictures, where we could document the miracles. But when you think of it, evidence is not proof. There's no such thing as proof. You either believe the evidence or you don't. And it doesn't matter how strong the evidence is. I mean, there is photographic video evidence of the horrors of the Holocaust. You can go and see them, but there are still people that deny the existence, that deny the evidence. So just last year, in fact, there was a survey that questioned people about the Holocaust, and they questioned Americans' youth under the age of 40. Okay, so young Americans under the age of 40, and nationwide, 63% did not know that 6 million Jews were murdered. It was a full 66% here in Vermont when they looked state by state. 10% just denied that it happened altogether. Even in New York, where there's the highest Jewish population in our country, 19% of those surveyed believe that it was the Jews that were to blame for the Holocaust. And so evidence does not mean proof. You either believe it or you don't. And despite claims to be guided by science, we tend to choose beliefs based on what's popular and convenient, right? Even things which are supported by science can be up for debate. You find, you look at the abortion debate today. There's overwhelming scientific evidence that a fetus is a living person with a heartbeat, a brain activity, a unique DNA. But those facts are unpopular, and so it's easier to believe that a fetus is just a lump of tissue, like a hangnail or tumor. But the most unpopular evidence is the fact of the resurrection, for many of the reasons I mentioned, because without the resurrection, there is no reason to believe any of the teachings of Jesus. If Jesus is who he says he is, if Jesus did what he said he would do, then we can't remain indifferent. We can't remain indifferent. We either need to believe the evidence or reject it. And so I'd like us to look today at a couple different individuals that reacted to the evidence of the resurrection. And so if you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to the Gospel according to John. The Gospel according to John. If you need a Bible, there's a bookshelf in the back. I'll be reading out of the ESV today. You're welcome to take one. My guess is that most of you, if we're honest with ourselves, most of us, even Christians, have faced doubts. Some of you have overcome those doubts, but I know there's a lot of people that can't turn those doubts, can't turn those questions off, and they're a hurdle to faith or a hurdle to their belief. I think there's a lot of people, maybe people that are watching, that would genuinely like to believe in a resurrected Jesus, but they feel like, okay, I got to turn my mind off in order to believe that. Some people are just pessimistic and skeptical by nature. Some people, they're going to just question everything, regardless of what they see, regardless of the evidence. I heard a story about an old farmer. He liked to duck hunt, and he got a new bird dog, and he was floored when he took this dog hunting, and he realized, okay, he shot a bird, and the dog jumped out on the lake, ran across the water, like not even getting his paws fully submerged, retrieved the duck and ran back across the water, brought in the duck, dropped it at his feet. He was floored. And he said, I have a friend who is a pessimist, who is skeptic by nature. He's going to be floored by this too. I mean, you could make a comment about how bright the sunshine was, how great the weather was, and this farmer friend would say, it's going to burn all my crops. Right? That's the kind of guy that he was. And so he takes his friend duck hunting. They go to the shore. A flock of ducks goes up. They both take a shot. A bird falls into the water. The dog runs out across the water, picks up the bird, runs back across the water, and the friend sees everything, but it doesn't say a word. On the drive home, the farmer finally asks his friend, hey, did you notice anything unusual about my dog? The friend said, I sure did. He can't swim. Right? So some people are pessimists. They won't believe it, even if they see the evidence. Some people, they don't shake hands. They just shake their heads. And it reminds me of someone in the Bible named Thomas. Right? You might know him as Doubting Thomas. Right? Poor guy. I feel kind of bad for him. None of the other disciples get nicknames for their faults. Right? You don't have, Peter the Pansy, James the Judgmental, Moneybags Matthew. Thomas, he's the guy, he gets nicknamed. And so we're going to see his story in chapter 20. And here's the good news. Thomas, he's not a doubter in the sense of what a doubter really is. He's a skeptic. A doubter is somebody that, hey, they see the facts and they still will not change their mind. They see the evidence and it doesn't matter, they're not going to change their mind. That's a doubter. Thomas, he's actually a skeptic. A skeptic, he's not sure, but when shown the facts, when shown the evidence, they can and they will change. And here's even better news. God loves skeptics. And he wants to turn skeptics into believers. And so you might be listening right now, and you have some skeptical thoughts about Christianity, and that's okay. You might have honest questions about God, and there's nothing wrong with that. I just ask, be open, hear the evidence. And so we're in the Gospel according to John, chapter 20, and I'm going to pick up in verse 19. And if you're here with me, I'm going to ask you to stand in honor of the Word of God. And so to give you a sense of where we are, Jesus, he was crucified on a Friday, that's day one. Saturday is the Passover, day two. And now it's Sunday, day three. And so we pick up in verse 19 of chapter 20. Hear God's word. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. Now, Thomas, one of the 12 called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe. 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. And put out your hand and place it on my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this opportunity to remember, to celebrate the marvel of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. As we acknowledge, Lord, too, that some of us have wrestled with doubts and fears, we thank you that Jesus demonstrated how to deal with them. And so I pray today that you would help us with our unbelief. Strengthen our faith. Thank you for the life we can have through the living and reigning Lord Jesus. We pray in his name. Amen. You may be seated. I love the way John writes. I love the way that he tells us about the resurrection. John, if you don't know, he was one of Jesus' disciples, and throughout this gospel, he doesn't really refer to himself by his name. He calls himself either, you know, the other disciple or the disciple whom Jesus loved. He's not a braggart there. He's just reflecting the closeness of his relationship with Jesus. But if you look back at the beginning of chapter 20, we see that this empty tomb, it was first discovered by a group of women. John is going to focus in on a woman named Mary Magdalene. And Mary Magdalene, not to be confused with Mary, the mother of Jesus. She was a woman. She had her life changed by Jesus. She becomes a follower of him. And she was there at the crucifixion right after the Passover. And she wants to go where Jesus' body has been buried. And so John picks up right in verse 1. He says, on the first day of the week, so this is Sunday, this is Easter morning, he says, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, we know that's John, and said to them, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. I love that. I love that. I grew up with a brother. We pretty much made everything a competition. You know, I have three boys. Everything's a competition, even eating. Last week, who could eat the most tacos? Doesn't really matter what they're eating. Everything's a competition. Let's see who can finish carrots first. Let's see who can make the loudest sounds. And so John, of all the details he includes in his gospel about the resurrection of Jesus, he wants to make sure 2,000 years later, we reading this would know that even though, hey, Peter, he gets to lead the church, I beat him in a foot race. Right? I love John. And he also wants us to know that Peter and the rest of the disciples, they're confused by the empty tomb. But when John saw, he believes. Now, verse 5, and stopping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. So that's John. So now Simon Peter, he comes up panting behind him. You beat me. He follows him. He went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, again, who had reached the tomb first, gotta throw that in again, he also went in, and he saw and he believed. So there's a response, sees the evidence and he believes. But the other guys, they don't quite get it. He says in verse 9, for as yet they did not understand the scripture
that he must rise from the dead. It says, then the disciples went back to their home. Now, and even though we think that John beats up on Peter, beat him in a foot race, he's the skeptic and all. Remember, where is Peter at the moment? The last time we had focused in on Peter, he was a broken man. He's filled with self-loathing. He denied Jesus not once, but how many times? Three times. And we don't know where he went after this, but from this, from what we can pick up here in chapter 20, it appears that Peter went to John's house. They're together. It's good to have friends. Right? They run to the tomb. John gets there. Now three people in addition to this group are described as seeing the empty tomb. Mary, she looks in. John, he sees and he believes. Peter, still skeptical, doesn't yet understand. But now the focus turns to Mary Magdalene. Verse 11, it says, Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. All right, so she also does not believe yet. She is weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said to them, they've taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they've laid him. Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned and said to him in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher. I mean, you can just feel the emotion in these words. Here's Mary Magdalene. She had been rejected by society, declared unclean, and now she is given new life, new purpose by Jesus. She sees him murdered in the most horrible, violent death imaginable, and all of her dreams and hopes are ripped away. I mean, have you ever felt the grief and pain that is just so deep that you just can't put it into words? Have you ever felt like I'll never feel joy again? If you've been there, you might just imagine what Mary was feeling. She's alone. She's by herself. She's weeping. She can't be consoled. She sees angels. They don't console her. She can't be consoled by the man she thought was a gardener. And all that changes until this gardener speaks her name. Miriam in Aramaic, Mary in the Greek. I love that. The voice of Jesus saying in her name just echoes in her heart, and she turns to him in shock, and her doubts, her skepticism just falls away, and she exclaims, my teacher. And in an instant, despair turns to joy. And she's so joyed. I mean, she doesn't want to let go of Jesus. So Jesus says to him in verse 17, do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, I've seen the Lord, and that he had said these things to her. Now, I've read a lot of weird theories on why Jesus would say, don't cling to me. Was there something special about touching Jesus? The context helps right here. Jesus, he connects the clinging with another departure that's coming. I mean, Mary, she's so broken up about losing Jesus at the crucifixion, so broken up about losing even his body, what she thought was a dead body from the tomb. Now she doesn't want to let go. For her, Jesus is a physical presence. And so Jesus, he's preparing her for another departure. Hey, things are going to be different. The physical presence is going to be a spiritual presence. Paul said that in 2 Corinthians 5. Says, even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. In other words, you and I, we don't have a physical relationship with Jesus. We can't touch him. We can't see his physical body. We have a spiritual relationship with him. And so Jesus, he tells Mary, hey, my departure is coming. I'm going to ascend to the Father. Go and tell the other disciples. And notice, too, I love that. It's not just my Father. It's my Father and your Father. It's not just my God. It's my God and your God right there, too. Now there is a relationship made possible through my death, through my resurrection. So then we get to verse 19, the evening of that day. So it's Sunday night, the first day of the week. The doors are locked. The disciples, they're there for fear of the Jews. They're hunkered down, right? They think, hey, I'm next on the hit list. Nobody's going in, going out. And all of a sudden, Jesus is there among them. I mean, earlier Jesus had promised peace, back in chapter 14, peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. And now, I mean, the battle's been won, peace is possible, there is a relationship with God, Christ, through his death, has brought peace with God. And then he shows them that the evidence, hey, this is really me, all right? This is not an illusion, this is not just a manifestation. Notice that the disciples are still skeptical, they need evidence. And so he shows them his hands and his side. And now it says the disciples, they're glad when they saw the Lord. He's bringing them to a point of recognition and gladness. And he said to them again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I'm sending you. And again, there's a commissioning here. And when he said this, he breathes on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they're forgiven them. If you withhold the forgiveness from any, it is withheld. Now, I don't think that they actually did receive the Holy Spirit here. I think they're commanded to, and I think this is preparation for when they would receive the Spirit. All right, so here's the command. He said, after I go to the Father, I will send the Spirit. And so they're still powerless, they're still weak, they're still skeptical, they're still hiding in fear after this. I mean, Peter, he goes back to fishing later on. They're glad, they're happy to see Jesus, but they're not ready to jump back in and follow Jesus. So they're commanded here, and then they're going to receive the Spirit when? At Pentecost, right? And so that's when they're actually going to be sealed with the Spirit, when they're going to be changed. The work is done. Jesus died and rose again. Forgiveness is possible. And that's why if somebody believes in Jesus, we can say with certainty, your sins are forgiven. And on the flip side, we can say, hey, even though Jesus died on the cross and paid the penalty for your sin, if you don't receive his forgiveness, you're not forgiven. You're paying the penalty for your sins. And the wages of sin is what? Death. And by the way, Jesus doesn't just commission his disciples, the apostles here. Anyone who receives Jesus, Lord and Savior, is commissioned by Jesus, is sealed with the Spirit. That's what it means when I say, go be the church. We do what Christians do. The church is the assembled people of God, and we are entrusted with the good news that has the power to transform hearts and impact eternity. Jesus died and rose again. And some of us understand that. Some of you, maybe some watching right now, need to just grasp some more evidence, which brings us to Thomas. I mean, he's the patron saint of skeptics here. Verse 24, now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin. All right, we don't really know who the twin is, but that was his nickname, apparently, before he got the nickname Doubting Thomas. But he was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe. In other words, hey, you guys, I mean, you're weak, you're simple-minded. I believe in science, right? I see no evidence, I see no proof, right? He's the skeptic, but he's honest about his skepticism, and we can appreciate that. If you go back a few years, Jesus, he told his disciples, hey, we're going to go to Jerusalem. And his disciples are like, hey, that's a bad idea. They want to kill you, and Jesus says, nah, we're going. And Thomas says, hey, let's go that we may die with him. Right? That's Thomas's reaction. In the upper room, Jesus tells them, where I'm going, you know the way. And you can imagine all the other disciples, yeah, okay. Yeah, they're nodding their heads. Thomas speaks up like, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? Right? He's honest about who he is, and he's honest about his skepticism. But he is also skeptical of his ability to change, to be a believer, to be a person of faith. And so here he is, and all the guys are so excited. They're trying to convince Thomas, hey, share in our joy, believe my word. And Thomas, he's cynical, he's honest. He's like, hey, sorry, guy, that's not me. You're right. I saw him die. It's over. There's no substantial reason for me to believe. Now, we would say, hey, Thomas, what's wrong with you? But he's not the only skeptic in the Bible. I mean, you have guys like John the Baptist. Remember, I mean, he is a relative of Jesus, and he gets discouraged, and he sends word to Jesus saying, hey, are you the one that we're looking for, or should we be looking for someone else? All right, John doubted. And he's a committed guy, camel hair, clothing, eating locusts. I mean, he's all in, but he wrestled with doubt. You have Jesus' own brother, James, right? He went on to lead the church at Jerusalem. He publicly accused Jesus of being a madman, right? And then the other disciples. In fact, right before the Great Commission in Matthew 28 and verse 17, it says that as Jesus is ascending into heaven, the 11 disciples worshiped him, but we have this interesting note, but some doubted. Right? Jesus, back from the dead, literally like levitating right before their eyes. And some of the disciples are like, yeah, I need some more evidence. I'm not sure about all this science stuff. You know, the point is, a lot of people doubt and wrestle with skepticism. It's not just Thomas. But Thomas, and what John brings out here, he is one of the strongest examples of somebody that overcomes doubts, overcomes skepticism, and believes. I mean, that's why we get the reason why John wrote the book in verse 31. These are written so that you may what? Believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you might have life in his name. And so right before John says, hey, this is why I'm writing all this, Thomas makes the clearest, boldest confession of faith in the Bible, my Lord and my God. And so John focuses in on Thomas because he's an example of someone that overcame his skepticism. So the question is how? Right, how? And he had lots of reasons not to believe. Right, in his mind, you know, Jesus was a letdown. He was the Messiah. He was supposed to have physical redemption from the grip of Rome. So he was supposed to come in as a conqueror. And here's Jesus, and he's friendly with the Romans. He says, pay your taxes. I mean, and then he dies in this public and shameful way. And so in the disciples' eyes, following Jesus, hey, that was a disappointment. That's a letdown. We gave up our livelihoods for this guy. We hinged all of our hope that Jesus was the Messiah, and it all fell apart. I mean, Thomas, he had his heart broken at Calvary. And that's why he says, hey, unless I can see and touch, I'm not going to believe. I mean, and the question is, I mean, has God ever done something in your life that left you feeling discouraged and hurt? Has God ever done something that left you feeling abandoned and let down? Have you ever felt empty and disappointed by what God has done in your life? I mean, it's interesting. When I talk with people that say that they're atheists, that the vast majority of them, and some of you that might have had these discussions, the vast majority, you can confirm this, they face some sort of crisis in their life. They've been hurt. Someone close to them that died, they were abused. Whatever it was, a horrible loss or tragedy, whatever it was, it left them with a scar so deep that they rejected the possibility of a belief in God. And so Thomas, he's convinced, I can't believe. So we pick up in verse 26, it says, 8 days later. And so he goes 8 days. 8 days, and you imagine that the guys were continually after him. Hey, we saw him, we saw him, we saw him. He's like, no. 8 days later, though, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. It kind of always strikes me as funny. I mean, if a guy that you thought were dead, you know, suddenly appeared in a locked room, I mean, peace is not the emotion that I probably would feel first, but Jesus there, you know, he says, peace be with you to all the guys, but then he turns to Thomas. Verse 27, he's there for a reason. He's there for Thomas. He says to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. Put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. All right, and so with Mary Magdalene, don't touch me. Right, that's not what you need. You don't need my physical presence here. I'm preparing you for my departure. With Thomas, he needed. He's invited to touch Jesus. And you think about that. Jesus, he wasn't there when Thomas spoke to the other disciples and said, "Unless I see his hands, right, and place my hands into the hole of his nails and place my finger to the mark where the nails were, place my hand into the side, I will never believe." Jesus wasn't there when he said that. How did Jesus know that? And the answer is, Jesus is omniscient, meaning he knows everything. Jesus is omnipresent, meaning he is everywhere at once. I mean, that's some evidence. And we're not told if Thomas actually touched the hands or puts his fingers. I don't know if he did. He just speaks, verse 28, "My Lord and my God." That's interesting. A side note, too, there's a growing lie out there that says that Jesus never claimed to be God. I mean, here's a pretty clear indication that he certainly did. I mean, other times in the Bible, you had humans being confused with God. I mean, Peter, Paul, some of the apostles, you know, they performed miracles and people started worshiping and they're like, "Hey, don't do that. You know, I don't want to die. You don't want to die. Don't worship me. Worship God." But here, Jesus receives Thomas's worship. In 29, Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed." I mean, this is where the rubber meets the road. And some of you are like, hey, what's so special about Thomas? I mean, if Jesus showed up in my locked room and offered to let me touch him, I'd believe too. Well, I mean, someday every eye will see him in person, but by then it's too late. We might not get to see the physical Jesus, but we're not left without evidence. Our faith is not without merit. We have plenty of evidence, and the strongest of which is an empty tomb. Jesus claimed he would rise from the dead, and he did. And all of his followers, they went to the death believing that. Not one of them recanted. They were threatened, they were tortured, they were imprisoned. Almost all of them were executed for their faith. Not one of them broke. So you have the claims of Jesus. You also have the prophecies in Scripture that Jesus perfectly fulfills. And you look through Scripture, there are hundreds of them. And we're like, okay, well, you know, what's so special about that? Well, there was a mathematician, you know, as early as the 60s, went to some of the very specific, measurable prophecies in Scripture and figured out the mathematical probability of some of these actually taking place. You know, for instance, like Jeremiah makes a prophecy about the expansion of Jerusalem and then the order in which all these corners would expand. And the chances of Jeremiah correctly guessing that answer, it was 1 in 80 billion. And so this mathematician, he took 11 of those very specific prophecies and he determined that the probability of all those coming true, which they did, was 1 in 5.76 times 10 to the 59th. All right? I mean, it's incomprehensible to think of the size of that number. You know, that's 5.76 with 59 zeros behind it. It's just incomprehensible. And so, you know, there's to get help us get our mind around the size of that, the volume of the sun is over a million times the volume of the earth. Okay, so think about that for a moment. You could fit a million Earths into the sun. And so if you had five, you know, you round the number down, 5 times 10 to the 59th in silver dollars, if you had that many silver dollars, you could fill the sun with dollars 10 to the 28th times. That's how many suns you could fill with those silver dollars. That's 10 with 28 zeros on the end of it. And so let's just say our galaxy has 100 billion stars in it. Right? And if you try, I mean, even that number, if you tried to count that number at a rate of 250 stars a minute, it would take you 750 years nonstop to count that. And that's just our galaxy. If the universe has 2 trillion galaxies, each with 100 billion stars, you fill all those stars with silver dollars, you would have 200,000 times you could do that to be the probability of those 11 prophecies. And guess what? There are over 1,800 prophecies in Scripture. And so a lack of faith is not due to a lack of evidence. I mean, even atheists have faith in something. Right? We all have faith in something. I mean, you got up and you drove here in your car today. That takes faith. I've seen some of you drive. Right? We exercise faith every time you eat at a restaurant. You know, some restaurants require more faith than others. We put our faith in people that we don't even know well. Just this week, Daniel, my son, fell. He hit his head really hard on a rock and a gash in his head. He started throwing up. It was really scary. He has a concussion. And so I spent an afternoon with him in the hospital, and we saw a doctor, great doctor, and I had total faith in this doctor's abilities. I literally trusted him with my son's life. We put faith in things and people all the time. But when it comes to the most secure object of our faith, the person and the work of Jesus Christ, we convince ourselves, hey, I can't believe that. I have to turn off my brain to believe that. There's overwhelming evidence for the resurrection of Jesus. And there's real evidence even right here in this room. How many of you have personally experienced a life change when you placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ? Okay. There's evidence in this room. A creation testifies the existence of God. There is evidence. And the question is, will we hear it? You know, disbelief is not a problem with our head. It's a heart problem. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for good, for welfare, not for evil, to give you a future and a hope." And he says, "Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart." Our mind can't believe what our heart has rejected. Our mind will never believe what our heart has already rejected. And so Thomas, he goes from declaring his unbelief in the strongest possible words, and he goes from despair now to absolute awe and reverence at the revelation of Jesus. And I love that. And we see a couple individuals here, and Jesus is going to deal with Peter later, but he did not give up on Thomas. He did not give up on Mary Magdalene. And he dealt with them individually, where they needed him, how they needed him. Thomas had given up on believing in Jesus. Jesus didn't give up on Thomas. He ministered to him. And I think there's a truth in that God loves each of us as an individual. You know, with Mary, "Don't touch me." With Thomas, "Hey, touch me, go for it. I'm real. These wounds are real." You know, and Thomas, he believes, he sees the wounds of Jesus. I've often wondered, why is it that Jesus still had wounds? Right? Why couldn't God have healed them? And so there might be some, you know, reason that I don't yet understand, but to me, they're proof. They're evidence of God's love for us. The same Jesus that died on the cross, rose from the dead, appeared to Thomas, is right here in this room. And he might be knocking on the door of your heart right now. We can't see him physically, but you will see him working in your life. You may not hear his audible voice, but you will hear his calling upon your heart. One day, we will see him face to face. One day, we will literally hear the sound of his voice, but first, we must believe, and the choice is ours. There's evidence. What are we going to do with him? Jesus really did die on a cross. He really walked out of a tomb. And having faith is the recognition that the reason that Jesus died, that the death penalty was for my sin. My sin made me guilty. The wages of our sin is death, but Jesus paid the penalty when Jesus died on the cross. And we can either pay that penalty ourselves, or we can believe in Jesus to receive the forgiveness that he offers and begin a life with him as our Lord and God. He can give us that hope and purpose, but we have to let him. And I want to give you an opportunity to do that right now. I want to just ask us to close our eyes and go to prayer. And so maybe Jesus is knocking on the door of your heart. And you can either open that door or you can close it. You can close out every word and you can walk away, or you can open your heart and maybe do that for the first time today. Maybe you thought you're a religious person. You know, you believe in a higher power. Maybe you like the rituals. Or maybe you've just been trusting in your own goodness and your own good works. And you say, hey, I don't need religion. I've gotten by with it all my life. And I might agree with you. God doesn't like religion either. He has something better. He has a relationship with his son. And so maybe, you know, you thought you made a commitment in the past, but you're not walking with Jesus. And I want you to know that you can come back home anytime you can. And so I'm going to ask, if you're listening now and you don't know Jesus personally, if you don't know that your sins are forgiven, if you're not certain that if you were to die, you would be in heaven, I want you to be sure. I want you to receive Jesus. So I'm going to lead us in a prayer. I'm going to pray something out loud, and you can pray after me. You can say it out loud. You can speak it silently. Whatever you do, just pray it from your heart. This is you asking Jesus to take control of you. Let's pray. Lord, I give you my life. I admit I'm a sinner. Forgive me. I believe that Jesus died for me and that he rose again for me. I turn from my sin. I turn to you as my Savior. Help me to live for you as my Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And for many of you, if you've prayed a prayer like that, if you have given your life to Jesus, the Bible says you are a new creation. And what's more, you're not alone. You are part of a family. The name for that family is a church. And as part of the church, we are blessed and have the responsibility to share the good news of what Jesus did in our lives, the change that he's brought in us, to bring that news to a world that desperately needs to hear it. And that's what we mean when we say, go be the church, to go to share the love of Jesus with others that are in your life. There are other people that are God has placed in your life for you to love, for you to serve, for you to share him with. So start by praying for them. Start by loving them. Ask Jesus to give you the heart to share with them and the opportunity to do so. God bless you. I'm going to be available to talk. You can message me if you're watching this online. Let somebody know that Jesus has changed your life today. God bless you. Go be the church. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen. We'll see you next week.